worship here at the Moravian Church, particularly if you're visiting with us. We'd ask that you find the Ritual Friendship Pad. It's a blue folder. It's in the pew. If you could sign it and pass that along, that helps us know who all is worshiping with us today. A few announcements, a reminder that Vacation Bible School starts this week, so just be careful out there. So from 9 to noon each day, we will be very packed and busy here. We look forward to this incredible ministry each year and all the people who volunteer and help with it. Also, a reminder that following worship today and every Sunday in the summer, as long as we have this beautiful weather, we have coffee fellowship down on the patio. So plan on staying after and visiting and having an opportunity to have some light snacks and enjoy the weather. Also today, we are having youth band rehearsal at 4 p.m., also fellowship time, and we're looking forward to trying to combine those two things together on Sunday evenings this summer, so we're very much looking forward to that. Also, James is teaching a Bible study. It's a joint effort. People from all the different Moravian congregations are invited to go. It's on Thursday mornings. It's going to begin June 23rd up at the Birching Center. You know that place up in Egg Harbor that I can't pronounce. Anyhow, so, but they would like to get an idea how many people are going to be there. So a sign-up sheet is going to be out in the narthex if you're interested in going. And also it'd be great if folks would like the carpool up there to go up. So we hope we have a great turnout and support for that. And then finally, we are grateful that James Hero is back with us this summer as our intern. He survived a year at seminary. Let's give him a hand for that. So he's already been very busy and just really been digging and doing work around here for us. But I'd like to invite him to come up and share with you a little bit of what he's been doing over the last 3 weeks as he was at the Trickle Bee Cafe down in Milwaukee, and he can tell you about that.
Good morning. And just an added word on the Bible study, the sign-up is really to get an idea of how much breakfast food to bring. So if you don't want to come for Bible study, come for some breakfast. Just a good plug there. But I was at the Trickle Bee Cafe for the first 2 weeks of my summer. For those of you who don't know, it is a new Moravian ministry that is starting out in Milwaukee. It is being run by a Moravian pastor. She spent time with a congregation in Downey, California, and felt her calling was leading her to do a little bit something different. It's brand new. It's a little scary at times. It is in a rough neighborhood. The street the Trickle Bee Cafe is on is filled with boarded up windows and broken glass everywhere. So it's an effort to bring a little bit of light to a tough community. Their focus is going to be on community, healthy food options, some employment as well as volunteer hours. It's going to be mainly volunteer run. And just a sense of, again, something kind of bright in this rough patch of Milwaukee. They hope to be open in August sometime. If you go on their Facebook page, they have a list of needs that they would like maybe donated. I think she's still looking for various things like cloth napkins, things that are reusable. She's always looking for plant seeds. They have a few community garden spots in Milwaukee, and they grow most of their own food. And they also have sign-up sheets for work days. If you have a Saturday and you want to go down and lend a hand, her mom and dad are carpenters, which is biblically fitting to have carpenters work. Your mom and dad carpenters, blah, blah, blah. But they're always looking for an extra hand. We're trying to get a mission team maybe to go down early August to help with their final stages. So if you want to check them out and lend a hand, or if you're in the Milwaukee area after they open up, go pay a visit and get a meal. It's a really cool Moravian opportunity right in the city, so please check it out. Thank you.
And now let us prepare our hearts to be in worship. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving, and let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. I invite you to stand as we sing together our opening hymn, number 552 in the Moravian Book of Worship. Please stand. Please be seated as we join together in the shorter church litany. There are choir parts in this litany, and Ryan will be singing the choir parts as we participate in the all parts. And all evil, from famine and disease, from disaster by fire or flood, storm or earthquake, from violence, war, and bloodshed, from all the deceits of the world, the flesh, and the devil. Preserve us, gracious Lord and God. By your holy incarnation and birth, by all the merits of your perfect life, by your cross and atoning death, by your triumphant resurrection and ascension, by your sending the Holy Spirit, by your coming again to your church on earth, or our being called home to you.
Help us, gracious Lord God.
Guide and unify your holy church. Keep all bishops and ministers and church servants sound in doctrine and holy in life. Restore all who have fallen. Strengthen those who suffer for persecution for the sake of the gospel. Send us as faithful laborers into your harvest, that all may be gathered into your family. Direct all governments in the way of justice and peace, that your will may be known and done among the nations. Enable us to make wise use of the world that you have entrusted to us. Send help to all who are in danger, trouble, or anguish. Grant healing and the constant assurance of your love to the sick. Enable the dying to put their trust in you as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the world.
Hear us, gracious Lord and God.
Have mercy on your whole creation. Hasten the day when the kingdom of the world shall become your kingdom. Keep us in everlasting fellowship with the heavenly church triumphant, and let us rest together in your presence from our labors.
Hear us, gracious Lord and God.
O Christ, almighty God,
yourself to us,
Christ the Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
All right, I think that's everyone. Good morning. Is it officially summer for everybody now? Yeah? Whew, that's got to feel good. So we have Vacation Bible School coming up. How many have been to Vacation Bible School before? Okay, a pretty good amount. Now, as we start Vacation Bible School, I thought it might be a good idea to kind of warm up into things so we don't kind of aren't in shock tomorrow morning when everything's going kind of crazy. And I also thought it might be a good idea to show the adults in the crowd a little bit of what goes on. So I might need Maggie's help to, if we could all stand up, we're going to share one of the VBS songs with the congregation here. The only one I know by heart is If God Can Love a Deer, and so on and so on. So, the words for the congregation, because you're going to have to join in with us, is, if God can love a deer, God can love you. If God can love a deer, God can love you. If God can love a deer, God can love you. So if you're lonely, just remember the truth, if God can love deer, God can love you. And when, I'm actually,
a little bit of emotions that go into it. So when we say, God can love a deer, we go. And then we will, after deer, we'll go to cow. Cows go moo. And then the last one we'll probably do is turkey. Yeah, so God can love turkey.
Woo!
So, if everyone up here would join with me, we'll start with a deer. How about that? If God can love deer, God can love you. gracious Lord, sometimes we eat like a cow, or sing like a turkey, or we try to follow your plan like a deer in the headlights, but we are so grateful that you love us all the same. Please be with us this next week and the weeks to follow as we take your hands and each other's hands in guiding and learning from you. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
Yesterday, if you may not be able to tell, I think my forehead is a little bit more red than normal. I got a little bit of sunburn. I was able to spend the day up north and ended up watching the sunset in Sister Bay. And it came to me that I have lived in Door County since I was in second grade, and I don't think I've seen a sunset in Sister Bay until yesterday. So it's kind of made me think that there are a lot of things all around us that we take for granted because we're so used to them. And that was just such a nice experience a reminder of how big of a blessing is in our own backyard and how many blessings we have on a day-to-day basis that might just slip us by. At this moment, I would like to invite our offers to wait upon us for our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Lord, we humbly bring these gifts before you today, seeking your guidance and your knowledge, to use our tokens of love and support to better the people and your world. This morning specifically, we think of those in Florida who were victims of yet another senseless crime of gun violence. We know that this is a difficult issue that divides opinion. We ask your knowledge and your guidance as people from both sides aim to find a solution to end the pain and sorrow that is caused, and we pray for the families of those involved. We also lift up those who are grieving loss of a loved one. Please be a source of love and support for them, and help us also be a source of hope and comfort to them as well. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. And turn to page 632 in the book of Moravian Book of Worship.
Our scripture reading this morning is from 2 Samuel. It starts in chapter 11, verse 26. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. The Lord sent Nathan to David. When he came to him, he said, "There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come. David, hearing this, burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, 'As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity.' Then Nathan said to David, 'You are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says: I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul, I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own. This is what the Lord says. Out of your own household, I am going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do this thing in broad daylight before all Israel. Then David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan replied, the Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die.
Summer, it was always an interesting time for a college athlete. We, being a cross-country and track runner, we would end the spring in pretty good shape, and we would all depart to our local jobs, our hometowns most likely, with the responsibility of having to train over the summer in order to be in shape for the fall. And it was really all up to yourself. What we decided at Stevens Point was we created a Facebook group that you could go in each day, log your miles, and just post, so-and-so ran 10 miles today, so-and-so ran 9, to keep each other accountable. And as the summer goes on, you get a pretty good feeling that your teammates are doing their work and they're going to be in pretty good shape when fall rolls around. But not more often than not, that might be a little bit harsh on my fellow teammates. But sometimes we would show up for the cross-country season, and we would start the year each year with a 5K time trial. And those guys who were logging the big miles weren't running very well. Maybe it was a bad race, maybe they just didn't have it that day, but sometimes they never really had it figured out as the season went on. And you begin to wonder, what were they posting about? Were they actually running those miles, or what's going on here? So even if they were trying to fool themselves into thinking they were in better shape or fool their fellow teammates just to keep their name clear that they're doing their summer work, in the end it turned out that they in fact were not prepared and had been fooling each other and themselves. And now this doesn't just apply to athletics, it also, as a seminary student, can apply to the school realm as well, or really anywhere else in life. No matter how much I tell myself I am well prepared to write this paper and I can talk the talk, when it comes time to sitting down and typing the thing out, I find out how unprepared I truly am and how I was kind of denying the fact that I maybe wasn't so prepared to sit down and write this paper. Sometimes it feels like our lives are a little bit like the movie Ferris Bueller's Day Off, in that we are constantly, for those of you who may not know, if you've been living under a rock or something, I think that's a pretty popular movie. A high school student decides to fake sick and stay home all day, and he ends up spending the entire day covering his tracks. He has all of these elaborate ways to stay out of trouble. All of these very specific and inordinate things to keep his name clear, but in the movie, the principal is always hot on his tail, and he ends up getting away with it. He kind of follows through with the lie and doesn't get in trouble, but unfortunately for us, our lives are not like a Hollywood movie. In our scripture lesson today, David takes another man's wife after he kills this man in battle. And he thinks he's going to get away with it. He thinks he has committed the perfect crime, that his life will be fine, and that his secret will never be revealed. But as we've read, David's truth was in broad daylight in the Lord's eyes. There was nothing hidden from the Lord. And similarly, in our own lives, there may be those little things that we We do those maybe guilty pleasures, maybe things even worse than that, that we may think no one else knows about, so it's okay. Or even if someone else does know about it, and you can find a way to talk yourself out of it, kind of wiggle your way through, that it'll be all right. But the truth is that it is in broad daylight in the Lord's eyes, and that our little shortcomings, our little failings, no matter how we are able to perceive them and make ourselves maybe feel better about them, that is not the case in terms of the Lord. We often cover our tracks or simply ignore the ways that we fall short. It's amusing the lengths that I'll personally go to either ignore and not admit a personal flaw I may have on a day-to-day basis. And we're so afraid to acknowledge them ourselves, we're definitely afraid to let others find out about them. But no matter how well we're able to fake it, eventually you're going to line up for a race without the proper training, you're going to sit down to take a test without having studied, and those results will speak for themselves. And even before we're presented with those situations in our lives, we are forced to come with hiding our excuses or the false sense of preparedness. God sees our true actions. We may think our own secret is ours and ours alone to deal with, but in truth it is between us and God. We may have others fooled into thinking we are handling things well, but that is not always the case. And it's incredibly tempting to hide these shortcomings or to ignore them, but in reality that only breeds a space for the shortcomings to become a habit and become a bigger part of your life with the potential for greater things to come about. It may be one of the oldest cliches in the book, but the first step to solving a problem is admitting you have one. We should confront the ways we know we fall short and seek God to guide us through them and take us to the other side. This requires genuine humility and honesty, and it's not easy to acknowledge the only ways we fall short. But God will be there to provide for us and forgive us. Just as David has this messenger, Nathan, sent to him and sees such a horrible example of human behavior and is enraged and doesn't even realize that he is the man. But instead of making excuses or finding a way to work himself out of it, he simply states, "I have sinned against the Lord." And just like that, he is forgiven. But before we address any of these problems we may have in a day-to-day life, we should take a step back and look at something else that can be relatively easy to fake, and that being our own faith. At times, we are guilty of going through the motions or making the appearance that our faith is perhaps something that it is not. We show up on Sundays or we quote a scripture in our Facebook posts, and everyone around us may think that we are solid in our faith lives and there is no concern, we are walking with God. But sometimes the reality is a very different story from that. And we have ourselves fooled, but God again is seeing us in broad daylight. And I want to stress that this perhaps doesn't have the negative connotation that it may sound like it does, that we're lying about our faith. And while it is true, there may be a gap between the faith we represent and the faith we act on a day-to-day basis. There's also the flip side of those times when we're too proud or too stubborn to show grief or to show pain, that God still sees that in broad daylight. And while you may be putting on a tough face for those around you and those close to you or in your faith community, God knows you're struggling, perhaps even more than you know you're struggling yourself. We may be keeping it a secret or find a way to cover up the things we struggle with, but again, God sees it all. And how amazing is it that the same God who sees those shortcomings is the same God who can lend us strength before we know we need it? I think sometimes I'm guilty of, from a Dairy Queen background, I think of sometimes having a sort of a coupon system for God, that You can redeem a forgiveness of sins coupon, or you can ask for strength and guidance, but you can only use one per visit. But it's incredible that that is not the case. The same God who will do whatever necessary to look past your sins and forgive them, just like he forgave David's actions, is the same God who will clean your name and give you the strength that you need. So as we approach the Lord's table this morning, I invite you to bring all of those little secrets that perhaps weigh you down at times. Don't try to hide them. Don't try to keep them from anyone. Bring them in your hands, because we have a God who's willing to take them from us. Amen.
Our service for Holy Communion this morning is found on page 196 in the front of the Moravian Book of Worship. In the Moravian Church, we practice an open communion. That means all who profess Christ are welcome to join us in this celebration. I'd like to just explain a little bit about how we serve communion in the Moravian Church. The elements will be brought to you, the bread and the cup. We'd ask that you stand with everyone in your pew, and you will receive them, and then hold on to them once you've received them, and then once all of us have been served, we partake together. This is a reminder to us that our faith is not just our own, but it is a faith that is lived in community. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us pray. God of grace and love, we give you thanks that there is nothing that we need to keep away from you as we come to this table, whether it be our sin or our sorrow. You are a God who embraces us through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. And so through this bread and this cup, we are reminded that we have complete and total love from you. We pray together, Lord, as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Please be seated. Thank you. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." By your divine presence, by the holy sacraments, by all the merits of your life, sufferings, death, and resurrection,
bless and comfort us, gracious Lord and God. Amen.
In the same way, after supper, our Lord Jesus Christ took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Please be seated. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Drink from this, all of you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ, the Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.